true.
Sounds too good to be true.
So, can you tell me what is the employee retention credit? Why does it sound too good to be true? And how did you guys even discover it?
So I actually, it was my intern who brought it to us. He had heard about it from a, I think it was a tax podcast of a guy up here in Salt Lake. We're out of Provo, Utah. And he was mentioning it and he started looking into this credit. When the CARES Act passed those, like the stimulus package for individual people, they passed the PPP and the other one called the EIDL. The other one that nobody knew about was this ERC, the Employee Retention Credit. And it's funny because most accountants don't even know what it is. I've interviewed accountants since then, and they're like, "What is it that you're doing?" So that was something that was new for us as well. And it was like nobody had really heard about it or knew kind of what it was. But essentially, what it is it's basically an incentive for people to keep their employees or to be self-employed, and helps them to be able to have some sort of, it's kind of like a stimulus for your
Got
business.
it.
So to put it as simply as I can, if you earn $10,000 or more this year, you would qualify for the maximum credit up to
Got it.
$5,000. Okay. So the IRS is going to say, okay, we're going to send you a credit for $5,000 minus the payroll tax. So they take the payroll tax out. So you end up getting a check typically for about $3,500. And this applies for basically every 1099 contractor. All we need to do is restructure their business and then all of a sudden they apply, as long as COVID affected them. But I can't imagine anyone in the country not being affected by COVID. So yeah, there's a few stipulations that the IRS has, but
For sure.
it's pretty
Yeah,
amazing.
and we'll definitely get into those stipulations in a second because but I think like you mentioned, I mean, I like the way you put it, it's sort of a stimulus for your business. How does it differ though from the PPP and even the EIDL?
Yeah, so the PPP and the EIDL were both loans. Now, with the EIDL, you could get like a $1,000 advance or like a grant, and you didn't have to pay that back.
Got it.
The loans, as long as you like followed the exact steps that they gave you, then you wouldn't, they would be forgivable. But most people, they didn't even qualify for the PPP. So we're actually working with a couple institutions right now that have, like one institution has 100,000 businesses that got denied for the
Oh, wow.
PPP. Like, send
Do
them
you know
our
what
way
were the reasons that
because,
they got denied for that?
okay, so they based the PPP off last year's income. And so some people, they just started their business. They started it like December, or they started it in 2020, and then they wouldn't qualify. And it was kind of random how they approved, because there were people that we thought wouldn't get approved, got approved for PPP, and then obviously on the reverse side. So yeah, so there's a few things there.
Well,
So
and I know, yeah, so that I think that lines up with our experience. You know, there weren't a ton of Uber and Lyft drivers and gig workers who qualified for that PPP loan. On the EIDL side, we released a video on YouTube. I'm looking at it right now, and now has 185,500 views. And so the EIDL program
awesome.
was quite popular. And it was, I will say, just from my personal point of view, it was really cool because drivers were applying for it and basically getting a free $1,000, right? It was the $1,000 grant. And that's what most folks were taking advantage of. And, you know, it's not a huge amount, but I think at a time when people needed it, it was pretty cool to see. You know, if you go through the comments, they say, wow, this is amazing. Thank you for the free $1,000. And
Exactly.
it's kind of a weird feeling though, because I'm not really giving out the money. We're just kind of, you know, doing a video on it. But it was amazing, like how many people ended up getting that EIDL, I think, from our audience directly.
Yeah, it's awesome. I think yeah, it's funny because I applied for the EIDL and I have an S corporation or an LLC. I got
Oh,
denied for
really?
the EIDL. I'm like, why did I get denied? I have a legitimate business. I've been affected by COVID. So it's just funny how the IRS and SBA work.
And it's important to note too that as a tax professional, I'm sure you're aware, but a credit is really the best of the best, right? A credit is
Oh, they're
basically
awesome.
free
Oh,
money
yeah.
versus a deduction or versus, you know, really any other kind of benefit that you might get. A credit is just straight free money, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, the cool thing about this tax credit is that they don't have to track it and they don't have to pay it back. It's just like the $1,200 that you got per person as the stimulus. It's just to put money in your pocket to keep your business growing or keep it going or keep your people employed. And essentially anybody with up to 100 employees can qualify for this. So, if you have, your staff on your team, I think we helped one of your guys, get it. anybody really that's 1099 or that has an LLC or S corp, either a single member or multiple employees, can qualify.
Yeah, very cool. So let's get into the nitty gritty. All right, put your tax hat on. I know it's the end of the day, but hopefully you're ready. So sure. we sort of, you highlighted what it is. I mean, I guess when it was established as part of the CARES Act. And first of all, when does it expire? Are there any other sort of high level details?
Yes. So in fact, that's why we are so busy right now. Mm-hmm. We're trying to help a lot of your listeners and viewers, mm-hmm. and as well as many other of our own clients. But December 31st, it ends. Now, both other packages that I've seen Congress mm-hmm. Try to push through have both included the ERC in conjunction with the PPP.
Got it.
So we might be seeing a care package come through that includes both. Mm-hmm. So you can get the PPP and the ERC, which could be, amazing for basically everyone.
Yeah, so that's good to know. So if people are listening or watching to this after January 1st, 2021, they still may be eligible. But I think we can all probably agree that if you're watching this right now, you should probably not wait, because I wouldn't necessarily want to rely on Congress, everyone
sure.
coming together on that.
And to be fair, we have to file quarterly taxes by end of January. Mm-hmm. And so really somebody could go all the way till the end of January. And there's the option that we do an amended tax return. Mm. The problem is then we get, it's hard with W-2s. And so it can be complicated.
Okay.
So we want to get it done before that.
Got it. Well, that's good to know. And so you mentioned that this was really for, I think it's interesting that it's for anyone from, like your average gig worker, 1099 worker, all the way up to businesses with 100 people. Are there any other stipulations? I mean, who exactly is eligible for this, I guess I would say?
Yeah. So there were a few things. Yeah. There's a few things that the IRS came out with, and a couple of those things included, if you had a full or partial closure,
okay.
and that's hard to define,
right.
because there's government mandated closures, mm-hmm. like in California, in New York and some of these other places, it was strict lockdowns. Still many places are on lockdowns. And so that would be included in that, especially for gig workers, because a lot of drivers, they can't, their business is gone, right? And in many other areas where, there's curfews after 10 p.m., a lot of their business is going to restaurants or to clubs and waiting out there for their clients. But if those places are closed, they're losing a lot of their potential income.
Yeah.
So that would be also included in a full or partial closure. The government also said that it could be a 50% reduction in gross sales. So if we looked at last year mm-hmm. and we said, okay, what did you earn in Lyft or Uber or DoorDash in June of 2019 versus June of 2020, if we could show a significant reduction, then you
Got
would
it.
Qualify.
So I think it's pretty easy then for most gig workers, pretty much all gig workers to qualify for that aspect. But I think you mentioned, so they can be 1099, but you have to restructure their business. What are the details there?
Yeah, so essentially what we found is that the best way both for them to save on taxes and to qualify themselves as an employee of their business so they can actually pay themselves a wage, mm-hmm. is to set up an LLC and do what's called, we tax it as an S corporation.
Yeah.
And essentially what that means is that your business, your LLC, so let's say Lyft pays you as your driver now. Mm-hmm. Okay, so now we're gonna change that to make Lyft pay your LLC mm-hmm. that pays you, your LLC pays you as an employee of your business. So now you're an actual, you get a W-2 from your business, you get a wage from your business. And if you earn, essentially what the IRS is saying is up to 10,000 or more, they're going to pay you half of your wage, up to 10,000.
Mm-hmm.
So if you make 8,000 this year, they're going to pay you 4,000 in a wage or in a tax credit. If you make, 6,000, they pay you, 3,000 mm-hmm. in a tax credit minus those payroll taxes.
Got it. I think I definitely have talked to drivers in the past about setting up an LLC, which I think is more for, it's a limited liability corporation. And so I've talked to drivers who said, I've got a house, I've got these assets. It seems like if you set up an LLC, especially in some states where it's very cheap and inexpensive, it's a good extra layer of liability protection. Are you...